Up here, Pat Stokes, everyone, SVP, Product Management, Salesforce Marketing Cloud.
Thank you.
Alright guys, thank you. Happy to be going a little bit early for the beer starts in the flow. I didn't have the opportunity to see Carmen's presentation before this. I'm always a little bit nervous about where's the room going to be by the time it gets to me. But I'm pretty excited. That was a really good setup for a couple reasons. One, I'm going to talk to you about kind of the rest of the spectrum of marketing. So we're going to talk a little bit about email, about SMS, about social, about customer journeys, about sales and service as well. Just kind of really fill out the spectrum. But the other thing I'm going to do is, I might bump you guys out a little bit because this is really hard stuff, and I'm going to add a lot of stuff to the spectrum here is how we think about things, so I apologize if we do that, but we'll try to have a little bit of fun. I also want to apologize to Carmen personally and to all of Google because they said they hate slides with a lot of words on them. I'm going to have a couple of those, so I apologize. The first thing I want to do, is just thank all of you. This isn't all of you on the slide. These are some of my customers at Salesforce. But the first thing we always do is thank everybody, and so I want to thank you guys for having me. This is a lot of fun. I get to speak all over the world, but it's not very often that I get to speak in the old Friedman's Bakery in Belmar, about a mile away from where I grew up, so this is a lot of fun, and I'm hoping it'll be a little bit easier than what I usually do. Last month I was in Tokyo speaking to about 6,000 people, and nobody speaks English there, and I don't speak Japanese, so you do your presentation in English, they have headsets on, they're listening in Japanese, you tell a joke, there's silence. 15 seconds later, the joke gets to them. You're past the joke, but they're now laughing. Which is a very, very difficult way to do a presentation. You also have to be in full suit and tie, and it's a crazy thing. At Salesforce, I'm actually known as the guy who kind of doesn't wear the suit and tie, so I never really know how to dress, and then I showed up here in a jacket, and I still feel like an asshole. People here in jackets, which I should have known coming back to the Jersey Shore. Speaking of the Jersey Shore guys, so I grew up here on the Jersey Shore, a mile away in Spring Lake. I'm now the asshole who drives down the Turnpike and the Parkway every Friday from Westchester County, New York, where I live. In a black Range Rover with New York plates, I apologize. but my parents still live here in Spring Lake, where I spent the night last night. This is a picture of me and a bunch of my friends when we grew up. Some of the people in the room might know some of the people in this picture. This is me up there. Wait, I don't know why I'm pointing to it. I did that. So that's me up there. This picture doesn't really have any relevance whatsoever, except for one piece, which is who this guy is. Does anyone know who that guy is? At least I think it's that guy, because this is his twin brother, so it could be him. But I think it's that guy. So that is Alex Faraday, who you're going to hear from later on this afternoon. So we grew up together about a mile away. I think I turned out better looking. Definitely not. All right, so a bit about me. So I went to school up in Poughkeepsie, New York, right by the Big Apple, IBM plant up there at Marist College, studied computer science. Left college and didn't know what I was going to do, so I just kind of started messing with things by myself. So I started building applications. One of the applications I built was called Crushes. We put it on Facebook. This premise is going to sound really familiar, or at least I hope it does, although it kind of pisses me off that it does. So what we did is we built an app that you can go on Facebook and anonymously find the man or the woman that you have a crush on and say it, and then they can do the same thing anonymously, and if the two of you match up, it anonymizes it and tells you that you have a crush on each other. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Sounds like Tinder. I didn't do a very good job with this application because it didn't turn into Tinder. It's kind of a bummer. But I did that back in 2005-ish, and then in 2007, through my kind of networking with the Facebook platform, I met a gentleman in New York named Mike Lazaro. He had just kind of come off a few successful businesses that he was running. He had run golf.com, it was brilliant. He bought golf.com, put a bunch of golf stuff on it, didn't care at all about golf, but then sold golf.com to Time Inc. for like $40 million. in and he said, hey, let's do a company. So I said, okay, why don't you buy brushes? And so he gave me a whole bunch of stock to do that. That stock was worth absolutely nothing. It was meaningless. I don't know why I did it. But we started this really kind of dumb company called Buddy Media. I say it's dumb because we were doing virtual currency on Facebook. Virtual currency is kind of dumb in and of itself. On Facebook is extra dumb because the terms of service explicitly say you can't do that. You can't have an economy inside of Facebook. And then we were really dumb. We actually named the currency Facebucks. And so we got a cease and desist almost immediately. And then we changed the name of it to Zuckbucks. And we got another cease and desist, which was really stupid. And then we went through a whole bunch of pivots. And kind of changed the company around, and in the process of doing that, we started to notice, hey, businesses are really trying to build presences on Facebook. This is back in 2007 when, you know, you had an actual Facebook page, and there was like an application embedded within it, and you could, you know, have your URL, and people could land right there. So we started to notice that not only do a lot of brands want to end up on Facebook, but there seemed to be a pattern for what they wanted to do. A lot of them wanted to run contests, or they wanted to have a product portfolio on their Facebook page, whatever it is. And so that all of a sudden started to click, and we turned that into basically a platform. You could kind of think of it like a CMS for Facebook. If you're not familiar with CMS, you can think of it like probably a lot of you are using something like Squarespace to build your websites. And so that's what we did. We kind of platformed up all of that and built a reasonably good business out of it, serving social presences up to brands and ultimately consumers. And all of a sudden, my whole life changed. We did that for 5 years, and then Salesforce came in and acquired us, and all of a sudden, all of that useless stock or worthless stock was no longer that worthless, and everything changed as we came into Salesforce. So how many of you have heard of Salesforce? That's more than I thought. That's pretty good. How many of you use Salesforce to some degree? Also pretty good. So Salesforce is it's about a 17-year-old company right now. Founded in CRM, customer relationship management, has expanded into sales, service, marketing, et cetera, et cetera. There's some really ridiculous stats here. Innovator of the decade, world's most innovative company 3, 4, 5 years in a row. I really don't understand that. You kind of like SpaceX can like launch a rocket and land it. Tesla's got, how the hell are we innovator of the decade? And really we did three things that have kind of earned us this these titles over the last decade. One, we didn't invent the cloud, but we were really the pioneers of bringing the cloud into the enterprise. So if you think back to 15 years ago, when you would go and buy a customer service solution or a CRM solution from Microsoft or SAP or God forbid Oracle, that would be on-prem, right? You would be buying that on-prem and you really only had access to it and thus your customers when you were in the office, which is a big problem. So we really pioneered that cloud model. While pioneering the cloud model, we had to pioneer kind of an enterprise subscription-based model that Wall Street would actually go along with. And so that really was a big piece of it as well. Today you know it as SaaS, software as a service. This really is kind of the new model. We're seeing more and more companies jump onto this model. Wall Street loves it because it has a concept called deferred revenue, where we kind of know what we're going to make next year, or we know at a minimum what we're going to make next year because we have subscriptions and we have long-term deals. So Wall Street loves this model, and we love it because we are incentivized the same way our customer is. We're locked into a long-term contract, and we need to make sure that they stay successful during that whole thing. And so it's been, a really amazing ride. When I joined Salesforce 5 years ago, we were 8,000 employees, today we're 25,000. That number is actually probably 3,000 now since this slide was created. So it's been really an amazing, amazing ride. The third piece of the model really was our philanthropy model. So you've probably seen Mark Benioff on TV from time to time. This is something that we really, really believe in, and I want to share it with all of you. We have what we call our one-to-one model, which is 1% of all of our employees' time, 1% of all of the company equity, and most importantly, 1% of our product goes back into nonprofits. So to date, Salesforce employees have contributed over 2.1 million hours of what we call VPO, which is volunteering time off where we go out into the community. I'm going out to Kenya for the first time in August, which I'm really, really excited about. And so really, it becomes a part of our culture. 1% of our equity, so we're providing grants. Some of you may know the Benioff Children's Hospital in San Francisco. We're making grants wherever we can. And then really 1% of our product. So if you are a nonprofit, and there probably are some of you in the room, and you want to use Salesforce, you can have it. Whatever of it you want, we will help you help make our products available to you if you're looking for a little bit of help in CRM or service. The way we think about the world is really in the context of what we call technology shifts. So we talked a little bit about some of those shifts today. We don't have AR up here. We actually probably should now that I really think about it. But really, Salesforce came in right around the time that personal computers were moving out, and we brought this kind of cloud-based ecosystem in. And the idea here was you should have access as a business to all of your business data and to your customers whenever it is that you need it. So if you're traveling, you should be able to get to it. If you're home, you should be able to get to it. If you're in the office, you should be able to get to it. And so really embrace and help pioneer that cloud model. We then shifted into social. Social really, what this did is it brought customers, it put customers in a position where they can engage with you and your company and your brand in a much more real-time and open organic way. We like to say that you don't really have a choice how you engage with your customers anymore. They will engage directly with you, whether you like it or not. Both of those things were compounded by mobile. We talked a lot about mobile today. I don't need to talk too much about it, but that really enabled your customers to engage with you wherever they want, and now it enables you to engage with them wherever you want, so really compounding that. And then today, where we are moving into this, these two new shifts, so IoT, for those of you not familiar, Internet of Things, there's 75 billion connected devices in the world. That number is also probably a little bit old. These are smart devices, so devices that can talk to things in your house and to the internet. So when you get one of those cool lights, you know, that you can turn on and off from your phone or even from your Alexa app, that would be a smart thing. If you think that Philips is not tracking when your lights are on and off to know when you're home and when they should be sending advertising events to you, you're crazy. They are. Everybody is. This is why Google bought Nest. I'm sorry. All of that data about consumers is now available to marketers if they're able to bring it in, and we're going to talk a little bit about that today. You can imagine when you have 75 billion smart things, the amount of data is basically incalculable. We used to think about social as, I'm getting a million engagements from my consumers. You now have a million event, billions and trillions of events that you can look at as a business based on these connected devices. And then finally, AI. So the real trick to all of that data is being able to apply AI to it. People like to think that AI is evolving now because the technology is catching up. It's not really that. It's that there's now a need for it. And when there's a need for it, humans create solutions. And that's what's happened. We need a way to be able to look at all of that data and make predictions about what consumers are doing. And so you're starting to see a world where AI is going to become more and more important to marketing. And I'm going to talk quite a bit about that. You're probably using it today and you don't even know it. And there's probably ways that you can use it that seem very daunting. And I'm going to talk about some of the daunting in these next few slides. But there are ways that you can use it or start thinking about it. And so what all of those shifts have done is they've created this age of the customer, we like to call it. So there's no longer the age of the business. If you think about the way this used to work, you got to decide when you engaged with your customer. It was that your customer was only engaged with your brand when they saw your commercial on TV or when they saw your ad in a newspaper or when they walked into your brick and mortar store. That's when you had an opportunity to engage with your customer. It's no longer like that. Your customer now controls when they engage with you. It's when they're using their app. It's whenever they want. And they want what they want. Carmen said this quite a bit. They want what they want when they want it, right? They expect that connected experience. They expect you to be able to connect. For example, your service implementation to your promotional marketing implementation to your sales presentation, right? If you get a receipt in your email and you reply, you shouldn't have to send in the order number. If you call somebody up and give them your name, you shouldn't have to tell them your order number. Simple things like that, being able to connect them all, that is the new customer experience, and we are now challenged with connecting all of that and making it work. If you don't, we call this the customer gap, and that gap is exactly where your competitors will come in, and I'll show you some data to back that up a little bit. But we've heard the phrase, I hate this phrase, but we've heard the phrase that millennials don't want advertising for products, they want experiences, and that's very, very true. You have to provide that customer experience, and if you don't, your competitors will, and you'll lose them, and I heard Carmen talk a little bit about that. The one that scares me the most is less than 1% of customer data today is actually being analyzed and acted on. And that number is not gonna get better, it's gonna shrink as IoT becomes more and more part of the mainframe. That's a number that we need to watch. So, whoops. Oh, I blew it. Backwards. There we go. Nope. There we go. Okay, so just this week, Salesforce announced the State of the Marketing Report for 2017. For those of you that pay attention to all of these reports, this is like the month when everybody's reports come out. So Mary Meeker's report just came out. If you've never heard of Mary Meeker, write her name down right now and go find her report. She works for Kleiner Perkins. It's called the Mary Meeker Internet Trends Report. It is like 400 slides of just pure, unadulterated data. With very minor conclusions on top of it, but the data is just amazing. Salesforce announced theirs, Accenture just announced theirs, so this is kind of like the week when all of the reports just come out. So ours just came out, we went out and surveyed 3,500 global marketing leaders, some of our customers, some of our competitors' customers, and then surfaced all that up into a whole bunch of insights and trends that I'm gonna share with you over the next 20 minutes or so, and then hopefully we'll have some time for some questions. Like I said, this just came out this week, so I apologize if I have to read the slides a little bit. I don't have all of the percentages memorized yet. But here we go. So the one main kind of macro theme of all of the data that we got back from these marketers is that brands are now competing for the customer experience. They're no longer competing for sales or for service metrics or whatever it is. They're competing for the complete customer experience because they know that customers can just turn around and leave if they don't get the experience that they want. Now, here's the bad news. The bad news is that marketers are the ones who have to fix that. They're the ones at the front of the market. You could call it bad news. You could also, if you're an optimist, you could call it, that's my opportunity. You could call it good news as well. I call it bad news because I'm in product and I'm the one who has to make all the products work together and bring all that data together, so it's hard. But marketers are called to lead that change. So now more often than not, when we go in and we talk to a big brand, it is the marketers who are leading that digital transformation. It's not the service folks, it's not the sales folks. In some cases, it's not even the CIO, right, who you would think would be connected to all of that. It really is the CMO who's bringing all of those people together. And that makes sense, right, because we're talking about a direct interaction with the customer, and marketers usually are that front line. So it's up to all of us to do that. So we looked at all of the data, and really three kind of major themes emerged from it. So first is marketers are moving to customer journeys. Who's heard that phrase before, customer journeys? Not many people, okay, but a few of you. So a customer journey, let me describe it like this. It is basically a completely connected experience, right? So Carmen mentioned it earlier. You are on your phone looking for a vacation, an expensive vacation specifically, and you're probably not gonna buy that on your phone and you're gonna go to your computer. It would be great if when you got to your computer there was an ad for the vacation that you were looking on in your Facebook feed to remind you and connect that experience as you go across, right? Once you've booked that experience, you've gone through an actual sale, purchase, it would be great if that ad stopped showing up, wouldn't it? It usually doesn't happen. Even with big, you go to Amazon, you go to Zappos, you look at a product, you buy it, it's still showing up in your feed. That is a poorly connected experience. As we go forward, once you've bought it, it would be great if there was some movement towards using what you just bought, right? Or implementing what you just bought. If you bought that experience, it would be great if that same company could then help you book a car, book your flights, whatever it is. And so connecting that whole experience together and really sending that user down a journey all the way from acquisition or from the top of the funnel down to the bottom of the funnel. And that's what marketers are thinking about now. They're not thinking about individual channel implementations. I'm going to talk a lot about that. Next is, in order to pull this off, there are shifting priorities, or as these priorities shift, it's sparking tremendous organizational change. This is both a blessing and a curse. We're seeing large enterprises really start to think about how do we model an organization so that sales talks to marketing more, so that marketing talks to service more. The problem with all of that change is it creates friction, and people don't want to buy software as fast as we'd like them to buy it because they're going through organizational change. But really important to take notice of that and think about what you might be able to do in your organization. And then finally, technology, particularly AI, is really raising the bar for efficiency and personalization and what the customer expects. And we'll talk about all three of these things here over the course of the next 15 minutes. Okay, so here's where all the words come in on the slides. I apologize. So we said marketers are moving to customer journeys. So 64% of marketing leaders say their company has become more focused on providing a consistent experience across every channel as a result of this. But why? Well, it's really simple. Consumers are leaving. Consumers will just switch over to another brand, right? Armin mentioned earlier, if you're going to go buy those shoes, you don't really care if it's from Nordstrom or, I don't know, what's another? Department stores a lot. Macy's, there we go. I'm trying to think of ones that are still in business. JCPenney came on first. That one might not work. Consumers will leave if that experience is not there. On the B2B side, same thing. So business buyers are actually more likely to switch if they don't get that really hand-holdy, fully connected experience. So this is incredibly, incredibly important. But this is really hard to do. Only 23% of marketers are actually satisfied with their ability to leverage customer data. But they're trying. 67% of marketing leaders are trying. And they know that it works when you do it. These are the things that go up. So your customer loyalty is going to go up, your revenue will go up, your customer engagement will grow up, et cetera, et cetera. I think probably most importantly, your customer's willingness to recommend products and services will go up if you are able to connect all of these experiences together. Just to kind of orient you to some of these charts really quickly, so as we move through all of these, the orange bars are from the 3,500 marketers that we segmented. The orange bars are the ones that consider themselves high performance marketers, and the number of questions were asked to get them into that category. The blue bar is moderate performers, and the light orange bar at the bottom is poor performers in marketing. So when you look at these stats, you're looking at kind of the difference between companies that are doing a very good job of this and what their takeaways are versus companies. So what is holding customers back from being able to do this? So this is where we may bum some of you out. These are the actual challenges that many of these companies are running into. So on your high performer side, number one, and we're going to see this over and over, creating a shared single view of the customer. That is effectively the CRM, right? That record that knows who the customer is, where they've been, what they've visited, when you've advertised to them, what they've bought, and then being able to connect that to all of the mechanisms of running your business, your CRM, your POS, for example, if you have it in store, your customer service line, or maybe your customer service Twitter handle, whatever it is, being able to connect all of that to the CRM, very important. Difficulty leveraging data from different sources. We're gonna see this again and again. It's gonna become more of a problem with AI. All of these products that are out there doing these things, they don't always make it so easy to get the data from point A to point B. Sometimes you can get it there, but you're not allowed to get it there because of terms of service issues or privacy issues. We have the good fortune of doing business in the United States, where in Germany or the rest of Europe is even harder because of things like GDPR. Very hard to move your data around. What I find most interesting about this slide, though, is the high performers are kind of talking about actual implementation things, and I see this all the time. The underperformers are like, yeah, they don't give me any budget, and I don't have enough resources, which seems like an excuse to me. But I think you probably see that for basically any underperformer question you want. You have to go around that. All right, so this gets a little bit harder. So new channels are not doing you any favors. Both in B2B and B2C, tremendous growth in the amount of budget being spent on these five new channels. One of the things I think that's most interesting is 34% of marketers, on average, marketing leaders are saying that 34% of their budget is now spent on channels that did not exist 5 years ago, right? So you can imagine going to Don Draper in 1960, pitching him like, you know, you wanted to give you like an Ovaltine commercial, and he's like, great, I'll do the 30-second spot on the commercial. Well, now they're telling him, and then we need like an Instagram story, and we need Instagram pictures, and we need you to get on Snapchat, and we need videos for Facebook, and you know, we need a mobile app, and we need to go find like Kylie Jenner as an influencer to come in, and we'll do like a festival in the Bahamas for it. You know, like really, really, really difficult to pull this all off, and every single day these networks are changing. I make a joke with my boss, we do a lot with email as well, which we'll talk about, and I say I envy the people that work on email, because in like 1976 somebody wrote an email RFC, which is basically like the standard for how email works, and it hasn't changed since 1976. And every day I wake up I have like a new roadmap, like 28 more things that I have to build for my customers that I haven't thought about yet. Really, actually what I'm doing there is in disguise, I'm telling them I don't have enough budget or resources. they're not doing you any favors. And then to make it worse, this is really important despite the lack of flip on this slide, you can't just duplicate your efforts. This is really important. So you can't just put the same content on Instagram and Snapchat. They're different networks. You can't just put the same pictures on Facebook and Twitter and on Instagram. These are all very, very different networks, and they have different types of followers, and you need to treat them differently. To me, there's absolutely nothing more annoying than seeing the same brand content on Instagram and Snapchat. That's not true. The only thing more annoying than that is seeing like kids' pictures on both Instagram and Facebook. Pick one network, you don't need them on both. You really can, and most marketers are doing this. They are just duplicating their content because they have no other way to do it. We often say you would be better off ignoring a network than you would be duplicating content from that network until you're ready and actually have a real strategy for that network. Don't let the consumers kind of pressure you into going to that network until you're ready to do it the right way. On to theme number two. So marketing roles are transforming to reflect the consumer customer's focus. Everybody's doing this. They are shifting from a marketing organization that's siloed and a service organization that's siloed. And we're starting to see all sorts of, I think the bottom line is the most interesting, despite it not being as bold. We're seeing new positions, so customer experience analysts. Go to LinkedIn and type that in. 18 months ago, you would have gotten zero. Now you'll get thousands and thousands and thousands of people calling themselves customer experience analysts. What does a customer experience analyst do? They basically just pretend to be one of your customers, and they find all the things that suck, and then they bring it back to you and try to get you to help fix it. And you're going to have a hard time fixing it, but they're there. It sucks. Lifecycle marketing manager, same kind of thing. Somebody thinking about marketing, even worse than channel-based marketing, is kind of point-in-the-funnel-based marketing, right? So your marketers who are doing top-of-funnel marketing and then your marketers who are doing bottom-of-funnel marketing. Having somebody thinking about that complete experience, right? So if you're Fitbit, what does it mean to get somebody to click an ad and actually buy a Fitbit, to actually turn it on and install the app and then continue to use it over and over and keep coming back to the app to where you eventually buy a second Fitbit, right? That full kind of customer experience based marketing is really important. So we're starting to see all these new types of roles pop up. So something to think about for your business as well. The other thing they're doing is they're starting to really align with sales. And this makes a lot of sense, probably more sense in the B2B space. But we're starting to see more and more marketing teams align directly with sales and really start to build their metrics off of the exact same things. And that might seem kind of obvious to you, but you would be surprised how often marketing has their completely, and we're talking at big, important, you know, companies that Bank of America, for example, marketing metrics that do not match up to their sales metrics in the region whatsoever. But for me, the one that's more important than marketing than sales is connecting your marketing to your service. There's a bunch of things here that folks really don't do or understand. I think the most for me is understanding that the perception of your brand, of your product, is the sum of all of the conversations going on about. So it's the experience that they're having in a customer service moment. It's what they're hearing about you on social. It's what they're saying about you on social. It's that complete sum. But the one that seems to have the most impact is customer service. So when you have a good customer service interaction, everything changes with that particular brand. And when it's connected, it's even better. I think about, I travel a lot, like a lot, like 180,000 miles a year a lot. And so I often end up with problems with my American Airlines flights. You go to the app and you want the status number to call to rebook your flight. First of all, why do I have to call? Why wasn't it rebooked in the first place? But you go and you look for that 1-800 number, and it should just be at the top of every damn page or at the bottom, and you have to scroll and find it. And when you get to it in the app, it's not even in the native app. They like force you through an iframe out to their website to give you the number, which doesn't work, right? We've talked a lot about that. And then when I call, they don't know who I am, right? They call and inevitably it's, oh, I have to connect you over to the, you know, to the right desk. What are we doing here? So being able to connect that and make those service experiences is really important. And there's some things that you should be thinking about here that most harm. So marketing and service, they really do need to collaborate. One of the areas of marketing that I spent a lot of time on is listening. So listening to your customers, especially on social, and understanding what's going on. If you're listening on social and you understand what's going on, not only with your company, but what's going on in the world, right? And there's a lot going on in the world right now. Some of those things might have an influence on service, and they might need to be aware of it. You need to connect those things. Works the other way as well. Your service teams need to be telling you when things are going on so that you can react accordingly on things like social, right? So if you have a product recall, for example, maybe you're not at the recall place yet, but all of a sudden the data is starting to show something is wrong with the product, you need to make your marketing teams available or aware of that. And the one that I run into most often, especially with more of the enterprise companies, is down here at the bottom. So being able to suppress marketing when a customer has an open service case, you'd be amazed at how poor people are at this. So you've called into service, you've got a case, maybe it takes a day or two to resolve. Maybe don't try to sell them more stuff while they're pissed off. You'd be surprised how hard that is to actually pull off and how few companies are trying to do it. And finally, the last theme of the day, technology. So while marketing teams navigate all of this organizational change, the technology just continues to advance, like I spoke of. And your ability to orchestrate your journey across all of these touch points is only getting harder. But when we ask marketers what they plan to think about in the technology space, the overwhelming answer from a growth perspective is artificial intelligence. So all the marketers that we talk to right now are interested in thinking about artificial intelligence and talk a little bit about that. But some here that really still, you know, crazy to me that they're still growing social listening tools. It's amazing to me that 2017, people still aren't thinking about social listening. And I don't mean a tool to help you publish. I mean a tool that is going to crawl all of the social media out there and help you identify things going on with your business, things going on with your competitors, things going on in the world, things going on with your customers, your segments of customers, right? What are the things that are interesting to your customers that you can listen to help inform your marketing, to help inform some of the decisions that you make? It's amazing to me that is still getting 30% growth in 2017. Lots that we can be doing there. What are the tools most essential as we split out into the performers? This gets a little bit into the weeds, but your high performers right now most interested in data management platforms. Who knows what a DMP is, data management platform? Wow, that's not unusual, by the way. So a DMP is a tool that will help you find more audiences, bigger audiences, right? So you take a known audience, maybe it's from your CRM, maybe it's from Google, maybe it's from Salesforce, maybe it's from Facebook, or maybe it's just a list of email addresses that you have, and a DMP will go out and help you find more people so that you can expand your reach to those people on the various channels like we talked about today, like Google and Facebook. Customer relationship management system, amazing to me that people still are working to implement customer relationship management systems. And then finally, the one that is persistent across all three buckets here, marketing analytics and measurement tools. So every vendor, every software product that you're ever gonna buy is gonna have some section in it called measurement and analytics, and there's gonna be some pretty graphs, and some are prettier than others. But there's two problems with those that I know firsthand is one, there's always 10 other things that you're gonna wanna see that they can't show you. And then you're always gonna wanna take all that data and put it somewhere else and connect it to three other pieces of data. And most people end up doing that in Excel, which is really not a cool way to do it. But there's always gonna be a need for better marketing analytics and measurement tools. So something to definitely think about when you're out there looking for vendors to help you do things is really explore what they've got on the analytics side. And then finally, or almost finally, so marketing really embracing the AI revolution. These on the right here are some of the things that people are thinking about. There's already some things that people are probably doing. So Amazon, for example, has been doing predictive products for quite some time. So it knows, you know, what they think you might want to buy based on what you bought in the past. That is a perfect example of artificial intelligence. Campaign analytics, digital asset management, lead scoring is a big one. So if you have a funnel of leads coming in, and rather than a human being going out and qualifying all of those leads, we can look at things like artificial intelligence to help us with that. Personalization of content, so if you're sending out emails, it would be great if we could personalize those emails based on the user and their likeliness to buy certain things. So all sorts of things here that we could be doing. Sentiment analysis down there at the bottom is a type of artificial intelligence that's been in market for really quite some time, almost 10 years now. It's gotten much better. But another really important thing, especially within the context of social listening, so understanding the aggregate sentiment of your customers about particular topics can really help you make some informed marketing decisions. But again, there are roadblocks. I don't know why I like give you the idea and then tell you why it's hard. That seems to be the theme of this presentation. But there are some roadblocks to think about when you're thinking about AI, right? I do want to be practical with everybody when you're going out and thinking about implementing new things. The number one one is going to continue to be and going to continue to get worse, which is customer privacy concerns, right? So, for example, Nest and those light bulbs, there will become a point where customers will say, do I want all of that data about what I'm doing in my house going back, right? Do I want Alexa to be recording the things that I'm saying in my house? And eventually, either consumers will cause that revolt or governments will cause that revolt, like we're seeing in Europe. Budgetary constraints, this is still very expensive to do from an AI perspective. You need two things. If you try to build AI yourself, you need lots and lots of servers, which get very expensive. If you don't try to build it yourself and you try to go to a vendor, one of the things that you're gonna learn very quickly is you have to go through something called training. This doesn't mean training you, it means training the computer. So for example, if you say, hey, I wanna suck down every image on social media that has my product in it, AI can do that. AI can do a very, very good job of that. And the product can be like way in the back of the picture, all fuzzy, and it'll still figure it out. But it figures it out because the vendor's gonna come back to you and say, okay, great, we can do that. Get us 10,000 images of your product in various forms and descriptions and lighting, and we'll pump them into our classifier and we'll train it. It's hard to get 10,000 images. You can't just go to the Google and say, Coke. Those aren't your images, right? You don't own the rights to those. You can't just go to Twitter and say, give me all the images. You don't own the rights to those. So it's very, very difficult to train your classifiers, and it can get very expensive. And then finally, data is stored in disparate systems. So the Google example we saw earlier, a search query. So that search query is looking at the query, it's looking at your past history, the websites you visited, it's looking at the ads that you clicked on. Well, Google has made all of that work by connecting all of that data, and it's very difficult for us to do, especially in the smaller businesses. So I'll leave you with this last slide, and then we have time for questions. We'll take some. So just in summary on all of that data, so what makes marketers tick? Well, the theme across all of this, what are the high performers doing more than everyone else? So high performers are 2.5%. Or 2.5 times, excuse me, more likely than the underperformers to be thinking about customer journeys rather than channel-based marketing. They are 4.2 times happier with the data integration that they've been able to achieve. So what that means is if they're able to achieve the data integration, they are happier with the outcome of their marketing. So really important as you're out there looking at vendors and thinking and asking questions about how to implement the type of marketing that you want to do, you really have to be thinking about that data integration and together, that's what will make you successful. They are 3.1 times more likely to be thinking about artificial intelligence, and the big one for me, they are 12.8 times more likely to be thinking about channel coordination and not just duplicating and thinking about channels as individual things. We want to get away from this world where you have your email marketer and your social marketer and your search engine marketer and your blah, blah, blah marketer and start thinking about the entire customer experience. And so that is the end. And these are our stupid furry animals that we have.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
In the beginning of your presentation, you were discussing the disparity between the beginning of the funnel and then towards the end of it, and customizing the customer experience through that, which sounds all really well and good. From an agency standpoint, how would you really go about doing that? Because you also said that email marketing is kind of like the past, it is still really big. And outside of that, what my challenge is outside of like changing creatives or retargeting after somebody is converted, how are you going to, like, what is the AI, what is your philosophy on actually creating that experience? Or if I'm going to sell, I don't know, like if I'm doing marketing for this table company, you know, what would you do? If you're going to take these technologies and bring them to fruition.
Yep. So it's a question basically, as an agency, how the hell do I pull this off?
Exactly.
Got it. So agencies are gonna have it hard, I think. I'll say that. What we're seeing is more and more brands taking, because of the data integration challenges and because of the customer privacy challenges, we're seeing more and more brands take that data in-house. They need to be able to own it. They need to be able to tell their customers that they're not going to ship it out to agencies. So first, it makes it hard, right? Something to think about, which is probably not the best answer for you, but it is the reality. I think what we say to customers when they're thinking about this for the very first time is, we say, don't try to boil the ocean. It's really easy to boil the ocean on this. And so what we would usually do is we would bring a customer in and we would think about almost like a campaign, but rather than a campaign, right, what is an experience that you want your customer to have? Not a campaign like we have to sell this table, but what is an experience that you want your customer to have? And that might mean you want them to buy that table and then have a great dinner at it, right, and post a picture on Instagram and whatever it is. But let's work backwards from that experience. And so that's what we're telling agencies to start thinking about, is think about the experience first, work backwards from there, and then you have the challenge of working with the company that you're working with to figure out how you can connect all of that data together to actually make it work. That's a real thing. Okay. I don't know if I've totally answered the question.
Not really.
Yep.
So what would you, is there a recommendation? How would you start? How would you bring that, your idea that you're saying, how would you bring that to fruition? If you're an agency, I can see it if I have one client alone and I spend all my time doing that with one client. That way you can aggregate all that information and make something out of it.
I'll give you the very candid answer. If I work for an agency right now, the first thing I would do is I would go do an audit of all of my software. And I would make sure that it's set up for the future and that you can be flexible enough to not have to use your own software. One of the things that we see agencies do a lot of is they come in and they say, we're going to use this for Facebook marketing because that's what we use for all of our customers and we're going to use this. And so for me, I'm the product guy. That's the first thing I would do is do a full audit and make sure that you're set up.
You said at the beginning of your presentation that only 1% of customer data is being analyzed and it's only going to get worse.
Mm-hmm.
So my question was, as machine learning and algorithms evolve, why wouldn't that number get better?
It'll get worse before it gets better. So the data is increasing faster than the technology to analyze it and a brand's ability to bring it in. It's really the latter where it's more important. So all that data is out there compiling and compiling and compiling. The technology is keeping up, but the brand's ability to take that data and actually start analyzing it is not growing as fast as it needs to grow.
Yeah. A question about, so you talked a lot about the customer journey experience, and then throughout you were discussing things like social listening and AI and data management platform. Where the hell do you start with this stuff if you're trying to, if you're trying to pivot from traditional stuff to customer journey?
I'll give you a similar answer. We start with taking a single experience, literally going to, we call it journey mapping. So you go to a whiteboard and you say, what experience do we want our customer to have? And then you work backwards from that. And then rather than the traditional way to start is, we want to do an email campaign, or we want to do a product campaign, right? Or we want to do a social campaign. Let's think about the total experience that we want and then work all the channels back into it. And a simple way to do it is just eliminate a whole bunch of channels up front. That's a really good way to do it. You don't have to have multi-channel. More important than multi-channel is, I don't know what the more abstract word is, but multi-discipline. So being able to connect that marketing effort, that service effort, that sales effort is much more important in my mind than being able to connect your various marketing channels across the way. If you can go with just one, the types of users who respond on one channel probably won't respond on the other channel anyway, right? So we always come back to this idea of a journey map, which is take that first experience and work backwards. And you, it sounds obvious, but you would be amazed at how many people can't stand up at a whiteboard and just answer the question, what experience do you want your customer to have with this product? Right? This is why Uber and Fitbit and you know, some of these companies have done such a great job. Uber said, we just don't want the customer to have to wait. And then when they get, when the ride is over, Uber's a bad example, they're having a tough week. But you know, when the ride is over, we want them to just get out of the car and feel that frictionless experience. And that's, and then they built the product based on that. They didn't start with, you know, oh, we need to figure out how to connect the supply to the demand. And, you know, they had to solve all that eventually, but they just started with that amazing customer experience of no friction to get out of the car. Yeah, back there first, actually. We'll get her next.
All right, so first off, Patrick. Excellent. I really hope I get a copy of that deck. Really good.
No problem. Actually, I didn't mention this. So all of that data and a whole bunch more is available. Just search for Salesforce State of Marketing Report, and you get the report for free. You gotta give me your email address so that I can market you later. But
cool.
You
get that's the price we pay. So my question.
You're gonna join
the
customer journey. That's what
we can be internet friends. So my question is, like, I'm the lead writer of my group. One of the things that you'd mentioned earlier was that the message needs to be different per platform, right? So my question to you is, can it be the same message just tailored per platform, or does it?
Yeah, no, totally. It's again, you want to think more about the experience and how can the platform best get you to the experience that you want. It can totally be the same type of message, but or have the same overall theme. You've just really got to think about the people that you're actually communicating with and how they're going to consume it as well is really important. So it's not a completely black and white statement of don't duplicate your efforts. There's going to be times where it makes sense, but just make sure you're going through the thoughtful process of thinking about each network differently because they
good.
Really are very
I watched my workload double.
One more. Okay, there was a question back here.
Really quick. Our current Salesforce customer, we use Exact Target. How well does Social Studio integrate with Exact Target and our customer database there, as well as
that was a, this is like a planted question. So I run the Social Studio product. That's actually my product.
Okay, so we'll talk later then.
We'll talk later.
Okay.
It's the old Radiant 6. Yep, that's what it is. So it was Radiant 6 and Buddy Media. We put them together, and you have Social Studio. And then we have to connect that to Exact Target. For those of you that don't know, it's an email marketing company based in Indianapolis. It's not part of Salesforce as well. So you can see what we're doing here, right? We're connecting all of this data together. So I think the question is, how well, roughly, is Social Studio connected to Exact Target? A point of view on Facebook Messenger, I guess, which we probably should have talked about. Reasonably well. I would say that the major component that we wanted to address with Social Studio first before connecting it to email was connecting it to service. And so we've done that. So, and maybe less relevant for small businesses, but the Service Cloud console that Salesforce provides is completely integrated with Social Studio. So as social cases are coming in, you're not managing them on your phone, in your Social Studio app, or on your, on a separate app totally. You're managing it right within your cloud.
call center application. So it's no different than an email or a phone call, and it's all connected to that CRM. So that's been our big focus. It is connected to email from a content perspective and from an identity perspective. So you can bounce from both tools, and your identity and the content that you're using across the two tools is connected as well. And then finally, I think probably most relevant to this room, it's also connected from a listening perspective. So one of the interesting things that you can do, I don't know how many people are know the details of this, but if you have a piece of first party data, you can send that to Google, and you can send that to Facebook, and you can send that to Twitter and Instagram, and they will help you find those people. So when I say first party data, I mean a list of email addresses, a list of social handles, a list of phone numbers, whatever it is. We can directly advertise to you on those networks with that list. And so one of the things we do with Social Studio is all of those listening profiles that I talked about, listening to people that are talking about your brand or your competitor's brand or something that's relevant to your brand, we can suck down all of those social profile IDs and then retarget those people on Facebook with advertising, and if we have it connected with email as well, so we can start to do that cross channel type of marketing. And I'll say 10 seconds on Facebook Messenger, crazy super important, especially when we start thinking about AR. One of the things that I think would be really, this is totally silly, one of the things that I think would be really cool is if I could walk into a restaurant, I said Uber, they took away the friction of getting out of a car. I have a 5-year-old and a 1-year-old. I hate the friction of trying to leave a restaurant. The waiter doesn't care about you when your meal is over. I'd love to be able to pay for, you know, order my whole meal on Facebook Messenger, pay for that meal, and be right out of there. And then you can imagine the marketing capabilities and the data I get from my consumer as a result. If we wanted to put AR into it, wouldn't it be cool if you could just sit down and take out your phone and like see the menu and the meal that you want to order right on the table in front of you, and like see them pour a beer and like the phone is over the beer and it's like right there on the table. In China they're doing it, because in China they have to have pictures and everything. I don't know if it's useful, but it'd be really cool. Anyway, Facebook Messenger is a way to achieve that. Sorry, Google. I think that's it. Thank you guys.